Good morning, AMC. It is such a pleasure to be back, although I couldn't remember where the toilets were. But really, so wonderful to look around and see so many familiar faces. To be honest, one of the most wonderful things is I only take 7 minutes to get here in the morning versus like half an hour to get to my usual church, Crystallite. But I bring greetings from your sister church, Crystallite Methodist Chapel. I also bring greetings from the ladies of the GCWSCS on behalf of the GC President, Dr. Teo Lee B, because she's a member of my church, Crystallite. Will you join me in a word of prayer? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let me begin by asking you a question. What picture comes to mind when you think of the word service? What picture comes to mind? For many of us, I suspect that we would think of something to do with hospitality-related service. So, for example, a waiter in a restaurant, a concierge at a hotel, or if it's like my church, very often the WSCS ladies are always the one dishing out food. And so typically we think of service. This is the picture that comes to mind. Now, others of you may think of domestic-related service. So if you are a fan of Downton Abbey, any fans here? Downton Abbey, you may think of the waitstaff in Downton Abbey, the butlers and ladies-in-waiting providing impeccable service for their employers. Now, both these scenarios, whether hospitality-related service or domestic-related service, provide a literal picture of service. Someone who, through their efforts and labor, directly meeting the needs or wishes of another. However, when it comes to serving God, does this picture still apply? Well, I will return to this picture later in the sermon, but today I want to introduce two other word pictures to help us think about what it means to serve God. Now, the first word picture is one of my favorite series of books that I read when I was younger, called the Choose Your Own Adventure series. Anyone here remembers this series? Yeah, you're then of my vintage. Many of you beyond my vintage, but my vintage, this is what I read as a child. And I understand from my husband that during his Chinese class, he would create his own Choose Your Own Adventure books using his Chinese textbook. Not paying a lot of attention, sorry Dad, to out your son. My father-in-law is in the audience. Well, so if you're not familiar with this series, the way these books work is that you as a reader play an active part in how the story progresses. As you read, at some point you'll be presented with two or more options from which you must make a choice in order to continue with the story. So for example, in Journey Under the Sea, these two choices are presented, and this is really from the book. If you decide to fight the squid with your spear gun, hoping to scare it off, turn to page 17. If you decide to signal Murray to pull you up at top speed, knowing you will get the bends, turn to page 19. So which will you choose, page 17 or page 19? So every choice leads you down a different path and to a different ending. Sometimes the endings are good, sometimes not so good. If you've ever read these books, you know it's actually really easy to die in these books. Much like our games that all my boys play nowadays, right? You die, then you respawn, whatever. So similarly, the good news is that in this book, you die, never mind, just flip back and then go the other choice. Serving God also entails a choice. But the primary choice is not about whether you are going to serve or not, like for example in the WSCS. It's not really about even where you're going to serve, in church or in the marketplace or in a home or even which ministry you're going to serve in. The primary choice really when it comes to serving God is actually who will you be serving, who to serve. And this is what the first of our Bible texts for today tells us, and I'm reading from the New International Version, Joshua chapter 24, verses 14 to 15. If you have your own Bibles, feel free to turn to them as well. If not, I'll be reading from the screen. Joshua 24, verse 14. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the God of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, if Joshua chapter 24, verses 14 to 15 were written as a choose your own adventure story, it would look something like this. If you decide to serve the same gods that your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates, turn to page 15. If you decide to serve the God of the Amorites in whose land you are currently living, turn to page 26. But if you decide to serve the Lord, hopefully that's all of us, turn to page 31. Now, how many of you here are first-generation Christians? Can you put up your hand? First-generation, that means you're the first in your family to come to know the Lord. Wonderful. So just under half of you. Now, those of you who have raised your hands, especially if you come from a family that followed a different religion, you would know that you were confronted with the choice whether to serve the God of your ancestors or your family of origin or to serve God. Over in Christalite Methodist Chapel, I have the privilege of being a chaplain to the students at Geylang Methodist Primary School. And so every year, we have a very special program called Good News Week. We do it currently for the Primary 5s and the Primary 6s. And so we invite Primary 5s at one time, Primary 6s at another time, to come for a very special chapel program. And during this chapel program, we present the gospel very explicitly to them and ask them to make a decision to receive Jesus into their lives. And because GMSP is primarily a non-Christian community, we do have many who choose to follow Jesus. Now, the way, I don't know if you know, if you have worked with children before, actually children often receive Jesus many times. Have you realized that? That was me. I wasn't sure if I accept Jesus. Maybe first time bo pake, you know, not serious. Maybe Jesus forgot. So I say again, okay. So we do see that phenomenon in Geylang Methodist Primary School, but that's fine. Every time they make a choice to follow Jesus, it is a real choice, right? Every time they say yes, it deepens the choice. And so what happens with those who do say yes to Jesus, we do a special follow-up program with them. Currently, we will follow them for 4 more sessions after that special chapel session, where we take them through the very basics of the faith. What does it mean to be a Christian? And often we will encounter students who are, like those of you who put up your hands, first-generation Christians. They come from a family that is not Christian. They may worship another god. Sometimes their family has no problems with them exploring Christianity. But very often, we do find students who say, my mommy or daddy doesn't want me to go to church. They don't want me to read the Bible. And so we offer that you can take the Bible home if you like, but sometimes they say, no, my mommy will throw it away if I do. And so for these students, they are beginning to have to make this choice that we're talking about today. The choice whether or not to continue to follow the God of their ancestors or to follow this Jesus that they have come to know. And I have personally followed with a few who said, you know, my dad doesn't approve, but I still want to follow Jesus. And these are very young students, and we applaud and we pray that, you know, this seed of faith will continue to grow and really become fruitful in its time. For the rest of us, including myself, who are second or third or even fourth generation Christians, the choice of whether to follow God may not have been so stark for you. Perhaps for you, as long as you can remember, you've been coming to church. You know, maybe in the beginning you have no choice, right? I mean, you want to have lunch and breakfast, you've got to follow your parents, otherwise nothing to eat, right? But at some point, most of us, if we still continue to come to church, we decided to make the faith our own. As the saying goes, God does not have grandchildren, only children. And so it was for me. Even though my parents received Christ when I was very young, and I don't remember, but I saw a photo of us, my mom, my dad, me and my sister, being baptized at the same time when I was very young. My parents actually never made going to church a regular practice. And so we became Christians in name, but not really in deed. And so I grew up a little bit confused about whether I was a Christian or not. I still remember every time I walked by a Christian bookstore, I would feel a deep sense of guilt. I'm supposed to be a Christian, but I'm not attending church. I'm not following Jesus. Well, when I was in JC, a good friend of mine invited me to church, not Aldersgate, another church, and I decided to go. And that's where I had to really make that choice for myself. I had to really struggle with whether I really believed in this God that the Christians were singing about. Do I really believe this book called the Bible? How do I know it's true? And so I wrestled, and I did have good experiences of God ministering to me, but I realized at some point, I wouldn't know enough to just know for sure. I would have to make a leap of faith. There were still a lot of questions in my mind. I still had some doubts, but I realized that God was leading me to make that leap of faith. And so I still remember very distinctly one day as I was brushing my teeth in the morning and I was looking over my courtyard, I told the Lord, "Okay, God, I choose to believe in you. Help me." And having made that choice, the Lord continued to reveal himself to me. And I can say today, I mean, I am a pastor, so obviously I never regretted what I chose. And I can say it's probably the best decision I ever made in my life. No apologies to my husband. Choosing to marry him, maybe the second best decision I made in my life. This day, I invite you to remember, if you have chosen to follow Jesus, remember that it is a choice. We don't just go along by habit coming to church. Every morning that you come here, even if it's out of habit, it is still a choice. You don't have to be here on a Sunday morning. You can be many other places, but you have chosen to come to the house of the Lord to worship him. And so today I invite you to just remember again that you have chosen Jesus. For those of you who realize, actually, I never quite chose for myself. I'm here because I followed so-and-so, maybe my mom, my dad, my grandparent, my spouse, and I just kind of went along because it was convenient. Well, I really hope at some point you would choose and make it your own choice, because that's what it means to serve God. It is a choice that you have to make. Choose God to serve and not other gods. Now, the second word picture I want to share with us today when it comes to serving God is marriage. Marriage. Let's return to Joshua 24, verse 14. "Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt and serve the Lord." Now, the use of the word faithfulness in serving God and throwing away other gods calls to mind an exclusive relationship of loyalty to God. Now, this is even more pronounced when we go back one chapter to Joshua chapter 23, and we read in verses 6 to 8. "Be very strong," Joshua says. "Be careful to obey all that is written in the book of the law of Moses without turning aside to the right or to the left. Do not associate with these nations that remain among you. Do not invoke the names of their gods or swear by them. You must not serve them or bow down to them, but you are to hold fast to the Lord your God as you have until now." Now, the Hebrew word that is translated as "hold fast" in verse 8 is the same word that is used in Genesis 2:24. "Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." And so holding fast to God is very much like clinging to, cleaving to, and attaching yourself to your spouse in a one flesh union. Indeed, elsewhere in the Bible, to forsake God and serve other gods is likened to spiritual adultery. And so in Jeremiah 2:20, God says, "Long ago, you," meaning the people of Israel, "broke off your yoke and tore off your bonds. You said, 'I will not serve you.' Indeed, on every high hill and under every spreading tree, you lay down as a prostitute. Now, the second part of this verse may refer either to the sexual rituals of the fertility rites of the Canaanite gods, or it could just refer to serving and worshipping other gods. Either way, God accuses his people of spiritual adultery and unfaithfulness. And so, just as marriage is about marital fidelity and faithfulness to your spouse until death do you part, so serving God is about spiritual faithfulness to him, to worship him and him alone. Now, perhaps many of us, especially who have been Christians for a long time, we think that we're not being in danger of serving God, of being unfaithful to God. After all, we're here, aren't we? We're singing worship songs. We are not praying to other idols, right? Well, if you are married, hopefully you would know if you are committing adultery and you don't do it. It's quite hard to just kind of, oops, I committed adultery. Generally, you know what you're doing. Of course, there's some gray areas, what some people call emotional adultery, and that's where you become very emotionally attached to a member of the opposite gender that is not your spouse. So that kind of goes a little bit into the gray area. Hot tip, if you're thinking of another man or a woman that is not your spouse a lot more and obsessing about them rather than your spouse, you're in danger of emotional adultery. So whether it's emotional or physical adultery, when it comes to marriage, generally speaking, we know if there is a third party in the marriage. How about when it comes to worshiping God? Are we aware if a third party has entered the picture? I hate to be the bearer of bad news, my friends, but chances are most of us, if not all, have hidden idols that we have already attached ourselves to. In his book, Counterfeit Gods, Timothy Keller has written a piercing and incisive expose of the idols that many of us, including those who profess to be Christians, cherish in our hearts. Keller defines idols as such. What is an idol? It is anything more important to you than God, anything that absorbs your heart and imagination more than God, anything you seek to give you what only God can give. Does it sound a little bit like a third party in a marital relationship? Particularly relevant to the word picture of serving God as marriage, of marital cleaving and holding fast, is Keller's analysis of what it means when we love and desire something or someone more than God. The Bible sometimes speaks of idols using a marital metaphor, that is marriage. God should be our true spouse, but when we desire and delight in other things more than God, we commit spiritual adultery. Romance or success can become false lovers that promise to make us feel loved and valued. We look to idols to love us, to provide us with value and a sense of beauty, significance, and worth. Now, any K-drama fans in the house? No need to be shy, because I'm one of them. Yes? You're also shy now. After I say this, nobody dare to confess. Well, I'm a K-drama fan, so much so that I actually spent almost 2 years of my life taking Korean lessons every week. I've only recently just stopped because it's just too tiring. But as any regular K-drama fan knows, the dramas often idolize romantic love. I mean, Queen of Tears, if you've ever watched, is a good example. It's a wonderful depiction of marriage and its struggles, but it does idolize romantic love. And along because it's Korea, with physical beauty and wealth. Salvation often comes in the form of the impossibly perfect oppa, who is gorgeous, well-dressed, smart, rich, always can cook. Even if they just take one class, they can always cook very well. And who is unfailingly sensitive to the female lead. That's not wrong to desire and to want romantic love or to appreciate beauty. I do, that's why I watch K-drama.
But it can become an idol when it becomes what we call the ultimate thing. And that is the problem with idols. Often many of the things that we idolize are good things, gifts that God has placed in this beautiful world. But they become idols when this good thing becomes the supreme thing, the ultimate thing, more than God himself. No good thing can bear that weight. Only God can. And so romantic love is one of the three common personal idols that Keller explores in his book. The other two are financial prosperity, that is money, and political success or power. Now, Jesus himself often spoke against the love of money as an idol when he warned, "You cannot serve both God and money." However, when I read Keller's book, what I found particularly illuminating was his analysis that often lurking beneath more concrete idols like money and success are the deep idols lurking beneath. And so he explains, sin in our hearts affects our basic motivational drives so that they become idolatrous, deep idols. Surface idols are things such as money, our spouse, or children, through which our deep idols seek fulfillment. For example, money can be a surface idol that serves to serve more foundational impulses. Some people want lots of money as a way to control their world and their life. Others want money for access to social circles and to make themselves beautiful and attractive. Other people want money because it gives them so much power over others. In every case, money functions as an idol, and yet because of various deep idols, it results in very different patterns of behavior. So you could be very miserly with money, or you could be very generous with money. That alone doesn't tell you or us whether it's an idol or not. We have to explore what is driving the way that you spend your money. Keller goes on in his book to identify four categories of deep idols. Now, as I go through them, and this being Pentecost Sunday, I invite you to invite the Holy Spirit to help you identify if any of these deep idols are operating in your life. And chances are, one, if not more, of these deep idols are already operating in us. The first, power idolatry. And this is where we believe life only has meaning. I only have worth if I have power and influence over others. We all know the saying, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts, absolutely. Most of the time, most that seek power and fame and influence are operating with this very deep idol. The second, approval idolatry. Life only has meaning. I only have worth as a person if I am loved and respected by, fill in the blank. Third, comfort idolatry. Life only has meaning and I only have worth if I have this kind of pleasure experience, a particular quality of life. And so pleasure is your God. And fourth, control idolatry. Life only has meaning, I only have worth if I'm able to gain mastery over my life in the area of fill in the blank. Now, a deep idol that God has shown me that has been operating in my life for a very long time is actually the second, approval idolatry. A core memory I have growing up is of my mom caning me when I scored 8 upon 10 for a spelling test. 8 upon 10, quite okay, right? Yes, parents? Okay, right? If my kids get 8 upon 10, I'm quite happy, lah. I still remember vividly crying on my kitchen floor, feeling very outraged, because even as a child, I thought, 8 upon 10 is okay. Why am I being caned? And why is mommy so angry with me? But of course, as a child, I didn't know better. And so I emerged from that experience with a deep belief, only perfection will do. Nothing less. And being a good firstborn girl, I went on to fulfill this belief in many areas of my life. So I did very well in school. If you look at my transcript, it was pretty much perfect scores all the way. If I could get an A, I would get an A. The only blight in my record is O-levels Chinese. I got a B3, dang. God began his surgical work of extracting this idol from me. And okay, before we go into it, it might sound as if I have control idolatry, which is I must have mastery over every area of my life. Like I have to be perfect. But really, what is driving it? Why do I want to be perfect? So that I gain my parents' approval. And also because my parents, like typical Asian parents, don't really know how to say I love you, and words of affirmation are my love language. And so I often would not hear I love you from my parents unless I did very well. They wouldn't say I love you, but they would say good job. And those words are like gold, gold for me. And so God began his surgical work of extracting this deep idol from me when I was in university. Like the other parts of my academic career in university, I pretty much got what we call a grand slam. Every distinction you could get, I got. But God challenged me at my graduation not to wear a particular accessory that was associated with one particular achievement, which means nobody would know I have a grand slam. Only I would know. But of course, I had begun to really encounter God in university, fallen in love with him, really wanted to pursue him. And I said, God, I will obey you. If you ask me to do this, I will serve you. I will say yes. And so I didn't wear that particular accessory. But guess what? After that, I regretted for years. Remember, this is a deep idol. One surgical procedure, not enough. But it was the start. And that was when the Lord told me, this is an area that you need to work on because you are in slavery to this. Today, my greatest temptation coming from this deep idol is to still feed the desire for affirmation through this very pulpit itself. What other platform do I have to perform and get regular feedback and affirmation? That's why you have to pray for your pastors. Every Sunday when we come here and preach, we are in moral danger. Did you know that? Do you know the most dangerous day of the week for pastors is? It's not Sunday, it's Monday. Sundays we come, and by God's grace, because God's Holy Spirit is powerful and he works sometimes in spite of us, and we as human beings can sinfully think, oh, it's all me. Or when church members are kind and they say, that was a great sermon, thank you, God spoke to me. If I'm not careful, the deep idol within me will say, yes, you did it. See, you got approval. And so every time I prepare a sermon and a message like this, I have to fight the desire to pour in the work and to craft the message to make it just right in order to gain approval. But because I know that this deep idol is operating in me, it is something that I have to always be aware of. And so when I find myself moving into that space where I start to feel anxious, I don't think this message is good enough. I need to pour in a little bit more effort. I need to read a little bit more. Often the Lord asks me, why? Why? Because it needs to be just right. Why? I need to get it right. Why? Not for this message, but for another message, I was sensing that again, and I had very little time to prepare for it because the last week I was actually not well. That morning, as I was preparing the message, I told the Lord, I don't have the main preaching point. I don't have it. He said, you know, just release it. Let it go. It will come. You don't have to get the perfect one. Just preach what I put on your heart. And so every time I come here to preach, I remind myself, my job is not to be successful as a preacher. My job is to be faithful. Faithful to what God has placed upon my heart. And whether the sermon bombs or it succeeds, that's his job, not mine. Can you identify your deep idols? In his book, Keller talks about various tests. I won't go into them in detail, but I encourage you to read his book if you are interested to find out more. But he says, explore, for example, what does your imagination tend to linger on? The things that we think about when we are free, when our mind keeps going to that, that might give you a clue as to what your idols are. And especially for Christians, when your prayers are not answered, how do you respond? It is okay to be disappointed when God does not give us what we want. But if it devastates you, and if it makes you so angry with God, it might indicate that something else other than God is your idol. Choose God to be faithful to, not counterfeit gods. The final word picture I want to turn to today is the first one that I began with, that of a servant serving. Now, my domestic helper, Tess, from the Philippines, returned home to her home country after more than a decade of working for me. And that's because, and I only just knew this, Singapore has an upper age limit for domestic helpers. Did you know that? Once they hit 60 years old, they have to go home, even if they are medically fit and well. And so Tess, even though she has worked well with us for many years, had to go home. Now, Tess has stuck with my family through thick and thin, particularly, especially, weathering all the times we brought in another child into our home that's not our biological child. And every time a new foster child joins us, it is always tumultuous, to say the least. It was challenging for me and Joseph, but it was also very challenging for my helper. Very often, these children would test boundaries with her, they would be rude with her, they would lie to her, and so she would have to, like me, forgive and love and learn and keep trying. I had so many counseling sessions with her. Counseled Akitla, counseled Tess. But never once did she say, I will throw in the towel. She agreed to go on this fostering journey with us. And by the end of that journey, when she had to go home, it was really hard for her because she had come to love each of my kids like her very own. And so I want to end with this picture, not to emphasize the act of serving itself, just like my domestic helper was a wonderful helper to me, but the heart behind the service of a servant who serves not as a hired hand, but as a member of the family. And so really, serving God, and this is the final part of my message, really comes from the heart of being family. Family. This is what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 12, verses 46 to 50. While he was still speaking to the people, behold, his mother and his brothers stood outside, asking to speak to him. But he replied to the man who told him, "Who is my mother and who are my brothers?" And stretching out his hand toward his disciples, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." And so Jesus says his true family is not the biological one, but rather those who do the will of his heavenly Father. And so a key takeaway from this passage is, yes, we should do the will of our Father in heaven. But for today, I want to emphasize the heart behind why we do the will of the Father. And so like my helper who serves me, not just because I pay her, but she serves me really from a heart of devotion to us and to my kids. And I know this because she often goes way above and beyond the call of duty. She does many things that she does not need to do. If she did it just because I paid her, she would just stop here. But she often goes above and beyond. Very often, taking money out of her own pocket, buying treats for my children, bringing them out on meals, all these things, I never ask her to do it, but she does it out of a heart of knowing that she's a member of the family. And so the same thing for us. When we serve God, we serve out of a deep knowledge of our intimate relationship with God the Father. And this is crucial because Timothy Keller in his book explains, we cannot simply just pluck out the idols from our hearts. Rather, after we pluck out these idols, we have to replace the idols with wholehearted devotion to God. And so he says, idolatry is not just a failure to obey God, it is a setting of the whole heart on something besides God. This cannot be remedied only by repenting that you have an idol or using willpower to try to live differently. Jesus must become more beautiful to your imagination, more attractive to your heart than your idol. If you uproot the idol and fail to plant the love of Christ in its place, the idol will grow back. In other words, we must turn from idols and turn back to God. Detach ourselves from these idols and attach ourselves even more fully to Him. And this attaching will only happen if you know You know that you serve God not because serving God will make him love you. You serve him because he already loves you. Recently, I found my devotion to God and serving out of a heart of love for him tested when something unexpected happened. This past Easter, and those of you who are my social media friends, you would know, I found to my great surprise that 13 years after I gave birth to my last biological child, I am expecting again. So I don't know if you can see, this one can barely button, but currently I am 13 weeks along. Now, although I was very excited and joyful when I first found out, I was also very fearful and very anxious. And that's because I have a history of multiple miscarriages. I've had at least 6. And if you know anything about medical science, the older you are as a mom, I won't reveal my age, but it is not young, the older you are, the chances of abnormality rises exponentially. My worst fears were realized when at 10 weeks, during a regular scan, my gynae said that there was something unusual in the front of the baby's head. She said the shape is not what you would usually see. It looks like there is fluid only in that part of the head. And so she said, why don't you come back 2 weeks later and do a detailed scan and we see if it's something we should be concerned about. Now, I was pretty calm when I heard the news. I'm quite good at controlling my emotions. But that night, and I thought my husband was asleep, I started sobbing in my sleep. Obviously not quiet enough, because he woke up and started comforting me. But I had to really wrestle in my heart if it truly came to pass that God granted me a child that was special needs. Would that be okay? Would I still love this child? Would I still see this child as a gift? Would I still love God? In the words of today's sermon, would I allow the health of my child to be an idol over my love for God? Well, I decided to share the news of my pregnancy and the possible complication with my congregation, asking them for prayers. And I told them that the prayer that I had been praying, and I asked them to pray along with me, along with, of course, praying for the health of the child, was the prayer that Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. Lord, if it is possible, let this cup of a special needs child pass from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done. And so in those 2 weeks, I really had to wrestle. What did I love more? My comfort with having a healthy child? Or did I love God enough that whatever he chooses to give me, I would still love him and obey him? In his mercy, last Thursday's scan showed that baby was perfectly healthy, with no abnormalities. But I share this today, that is not the testimony. I share this today because as I prayed and I told the Lord, if you should grant the desire of my heart, and it is still a good desire, to have a healthy child, I do not want to forget these few weeks when I have seriously contemplated that I may have a special needs child. And for some reason, that made me even more worried. The Lord kept bringing to my attention all these ministries that are reaching out to children with special needs and how churches can be more inclusive places for them. I'm like, God, are you telling me something? But I told the Lord, even if my child is healthy, I want to honor that because there are other mothers and fathers who are walking this journey and carrying this very difficult burden. And if I, as a pastor, have any influence and power, I want to do something to help them. And so, yes, I am joyful that my child is healthy. Of course, we still have a long way to go. But I am grateful that God has allowed me to experience this because, again, it has been surgical work exposing possible idols in my heart. The truth is, brothers and sisters in Christ, this journey of detaching ourselves from idols and attaching ourselves to God is a lifelong one. One sermon is not enough. One surgical procedure is not enough. But rest assured that as we allow the Holy Spirit to lead us, we will experience increasing freedom in our service to God, freedom from these deep idols, and freedom to serve God joyfully, knowing that we are his children. Choose God to serve, not just as a family, as his family. Come, let us pray. I just give you a few moments to allow the Holy Spirit to impress upon you what is the main thing that He has spoken to you today. Not just something, a new fact, but what is He stirring deep in your soul and deep in your spirit? Take some time to respond to Him, because He is here. Heavenly Father, it is out of your love for us that you command us to serve you and you alone. You know that we have hearts that are deeply restless and will not find rest until we find our true rest in you, our God. And so, Lord, if there are some among us who have not realized that we have made the choice to follow you, today, Lord, we reaffirm that choice. And just as you have chosen us, God, today we choose you. For some of us, Lord, you have begun to reveal to us the deep idols that are operating in our lives. And this, Lord, is a severe mercy. And even though it will be painful, but Lord, we surrender ourselves to you to detach us from these idols so that we will be freed for true, joyful service unto you as your beloved children. We pray all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.